says that over and over and over. And that was obviously before the blood, you know, before Jesus came and Jesus' sacrifice. But you had to follow it to the letter. But the other part was, they're making it like he's gone up to talk to the Lord. The Lord's going to give, you know, he's been up there, he's kind of come back, he's went back up there. He's going to get the Ten Commandments. And they down there, Sister Donnie and I were talking about the other day, and Aaron was right in the middle of it, and he had even told him, Aaron was his second in command, so to speak. And he was like, he comes down and this is Aaron. But in this us, look what they doing. I just don't understand. Why are they acting like that? God ain't gonna like this. But did Aaron take any responsibility that what he had? Well, they brought me the gold and then it just magically made a calf. No, I didn't. No, I didn't. And don't you think God knew that?
That's what he told him. He threw it in the fire and he jumped out of the calf.
That's so funny.
Well, why didn't you jump out of the bull, brother? Which y'all thank God.
What a disaster.
You got a little calf there. Why didn't it come out of the bull?
But we do the same thing. Like, I was sitting there thinking, Aaron, what's wrong with you? And I could hear the Holy Spirit go, don't you do that? Don't you go, oh, look at so-and-so. I don't know what they were thinking, instead of looking at myself.
Well, when you see a mountain on fire, I don't know what you think. There he is. I mean, the mountain smoke and burning on fire, our leader just walked up there in the middle of it. He done been up there one time. And we're scared to go up there. We're scared to even get close to the bottom of the mountain. He's walking back and forth up there. And he come down, he got mad at us, and now he's going back up there. And I'd be scared to death. You'd think you'd be on your knees just praying and being like, oh, Lord, forgive us, whatever. We don't know, whatever we're doing wrong, Lord, forgive us, because they didn't have a law and stuff then, so they were going on feeling. That's the worst thing you can go on, your feelings, how you feel. That's what society goes on. How I feel. It's okay if I feel it's okay. This is the way God made me. Yeah. Make it sin. He made it sin so you can repent. Sure it is. He made it like that, brother. Sin all of us, brother. But you ain't got to let it run you, brother. But fornication, and that is and unfortunately, it's not spelled out more in this day and time, because homosexuals, I guess they don't think fornication counts. They'll take a couple of verses out of the Old Testament and say that there's no verses in there about homosexuality. Oh, yes, there is. Unless you took them out to make yourself feel better. All right. You're going to take out all the ones on fornication. Good luck. You ain't got no Bible left, brother. Two-thirds of what Paul wrote will warn you against it. Go ahead. It's any kind of sexual act not with your married partner.
So I listened to a podcast yesterday, and this guy was he's a Christian, but he grew up in a Christian household, but he went to a church, and he was young, they got real prideful, the youth did. And one of the pastors called him back to the back, and he actually, now the man understands, that he was telling a demon in him to flee. Okay, you know, like, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. You need to go and don't come back, right? Well, the guy thought he meant him, okay? So he left the church, and he got into homosexuality. And I'm not going to go into the whole thing, but he was going through the things that God had done for him, even not, you know, when he was a homosexual, trying to pull him back in to Christianity. And he said, I'm going to tell you right here, right now, this is the point that I'm making. He said, I'm going to tell you right now, there is no such thing as a Christian homosexual. He said, he worked for the Bushes. He worked all kinds of stuff for Barbara Bush. He worked on both of their campaigns. And he said, we would go to meetings before Pride become as big as it is now. This was years ago. He said, and they would say the only threat we have to the gay community, gay, trans, bi, whatever, church and infiltrate them and make them be understanding and accommodating and all that, then we got them. So, and this guy will tell you, and listen, he died, and God brought him back, and he is on fire for God. But he'll tell you right now that that is exactly what they're doing, is that it is basically that they are trying to infiltrate the church, which we kind of already know that, and try to get us to come around to that. I said, well, that's the way the enemy works. He does
it's
that.
It's way worse than that. They started converting the word over 100 years ago. We've had over 200 translations from English to English.
There you go.
From English to English. I'm going to translate this book from English to English. Oh, man, I ain't doing nothing. I'm making me up a book, and I'm stealing 95% of this one, I'm going to change parts out of life.
That's exactly right.
That's what, and Jeremiah warned us of that, and I forget the verse, but he said, for they have perverted the words of the living God. All right, tell me. It says in here plainly, take it out or add to if you want to, and you get all the curses. You better go read Deuteronomy chapter 28. You want all the curses? We're about to get them. The church ain't, the saved people ain't. The world's about to get every one of those curses. Watch what's happening.
He also said that when his parents was praying for him, that the Holy Spirit told them to pray to break the generational curses of the family. So don't think that's not going on also.
It's also deeper than that. It's not. They went after the word, slowly but surely. And Americans don't read the Bible. And Max Sapp don't read his Bible enough to know if you change the word. If you take out one of the words. What if you take out that but right? Mm-hmm. What if you take out but now? Those two little words right there in the middle of that verse. Would Max Sapp ever be sharp enough to catch it? No. Max Sapp was born sharp enough. God gave Max Sapp a brain sharp enough, but Max Sapp ain't spent enough time in the Word. But I got teachers that have. I got teachers that did. All right. They changed this and make it suit their purposes. They take over the Christian schools. 100 of the first 101 colleges in this country were started to teach ministry. The King James Bible. Not the rest of them. The King James Bible.
That's right.
Not the Greek, not the Hebrew, not none of that. The King James Bible. That's what the first 100 of the first 101 colleges in this country was started for. Alright. Most of those seminaries now, what they are teaching, if you go into seminary now and you believe that the Bible, King James Bible, is the Word of God, when you come out, you want it. Unless you like me, and you just contrary. Brother, you can't change words in front of my eyes. I'll have a fit on you. And I read these articles where these people tear down my book. And they better thank the Lord, I thank the Lord, that they ain't in my presence. Because I could tear them up with my words. They're ignorant. And the first thing I could do is explain to them, hey, brother, less than 10 years ago, I was just ignorant as you. 10, 12 years ago, I was dumber than you. You ain't got to stay dumb. But you're wrong. You're wrong. You teach a young man that this ain't the Word of God. If you don't believe what I'm saying right now, call the presidents, all of them right now today, and ask them if they have a copy. Word of God in English. Ask if they have the words of God. I do. I tell anybody. Yeah, I do. They won't. Well, it depends on which verse. And this one's okay, and that one's okay. I got news for y'all, and they know this. If I tell you something, and somebody else tells you something, and we're talking about the exact same thing, and what truth says what it says, and it is what it is. This is the truth. Now, once you start changing it and taking words out, there's two verses that the man taught me that scared the daylights out of me and called me. I didn't know my Bible. I think it's 2 Timothy 3:16, I think. Study and shut up my workmanship worthy to be approved unto God, all good works, furnished unto all good works. And I butchered that, but every version, every English translation except King James took study out. Now, the only person I know that would take study the Bible out of the Bible would be the devil. If you ask any of those, and I would love to, overeducated people, why would you do that? And if I just had time to waste, I would like to go see what they put in there and see how enlightened I would be. To see what word they put in there that every first grader, every six-year-old kid in this country understands what study means. Study your spelling words, kids. Study your alphabet letter, kids. We're going to have a test tomorrow, 1 through 10, kids. Study your numbers. They know what it means. So you got to change it to make it easier. No, you change it to complicate it. You change it to disorient people. You change it to throw people off the track. Jesus said, if my kingdom is not of this world, if it were of this world, I'd summon a legion of angels. And then he said, but now my kingdom is not of this world. A lot of those Bibles take the but now out. That's the but now I was talking about a while ago. They take that out. So it says, my kingdom is not of this world. No, it says, I'd summon a legion of angels. And then they would come down. And then you take the but now out, and it says, my kingdom is not of this world. Well, to me, I'm uneducated, and I never went to seminary, and I didn't know what the man was pointing out. I'm like, but now, you lost it, made it shorter. Okay.
Made it shorter.
The book kind of long. Maybe you need to take a couple out, man. Maybe I can get through it quicker. But when you take that out, Jesus was saying, my kingdom is going to be of this world one day, but now it's not. But now it's not. That seat, that throne of David, that belongs to me. Jerusalem belongs to me. Israel belongs to me. I'm coming back to get it. That's my seat. I'm going to be a king. But now, my kingdom is not of this world. I didn't come down here to be the king this time.
Well, they counter you with, well, it's so hard to understand. And when I was younger, my parents and I had this conversation, and my daddy looked me in the eye and said, let me say something to you. He said, you remember the Wednesday night you got saved? I said, I sure do. He said, have you read that Bible that you didn't understand something? Now, the begots might get a little bit scary sometimes, trying to remember who all, whatever belongs to whoever. He said, but I'll tell you, if you pray and you read that Bible, and there's something you don't understand, the Lord will help you to understand it. And do you know, he has never let me down. So don't tell me that it's too hard to understand it. That don't work.
Brother Pete said that if the Bible, if King James Bible is too hard for you to understand, then go read Peanuts or Hagar the Horrible, or go get you some comics. Grow up. That's what he said.
That's right.
And I like it. Told that to me. Man, he said that to me. He told me I was scared to read the Bible. He said, most men scared to read the Bible because they tell you how rotten you are, boy. You ain't going to sit there and take that off. You ain't going to finish that book. You ain't got the stomach. You ain't got the stomach enough how bad you are, dude. I mean, he just called you out. So you tell me it's too hard. I'm still looking up words. I've read through and through and through it, and I'm still looking up words. What's wrong with that? You got a dictionary. anybody else in this whole world can go to apostasy if they want to. And I'm telling you, you talk about bad. I thought it was bad for the unsaved. If any of us put down Jesus, it's going to be worse for us than it will be for the unsaved, for the lost. And then if that don't scare you, I just don't know. And I don't blame God. I don't blame God. As much as He has done for me, and as much as He has showed me, as much as He has changed me, and as much as He has changed the way I feel, and the way I think, and the way I believe, and the way He makes me feel, and the way He has knocked tears out of my eyes, as many times as He has, and then for me to turn my back on that and say, I must have just been having heartburn or something, boys, I don't know. Must have lost my mind. Give me another drink. And him sitting up there listening to that now, after all he did for me, and him hearing every word, I don't need that church. I don't know what I was thinking, fellas. Glad to be back. Yep. And him sitting up there listening. Now, I know I would be mad, brother. That's when the wrath would come out. And I understand when God's got wrath. Oh, yeah. He's got it. And if you think about everything in here that He says He's going to do that all these progressive Christians just can't tolerate, if you keep reading after the bad, He tells you why. Every time. God don't wipe people out unless there's a reason. God don't wipe people out unless He warned them. God don't wipe people out unless He told them. There's always a reason, and it goes back to them going against Him. I don't want to go against Him. I don't want to go against Him. All these people going against Israel, pray for them. All these Hamas people, they're going to hell, man. Everybody that believes in Muhammad is going to hell. 1.5 billion and counting. They make babies faster.